Okay, hello everybody. It's been a long time since my last video. We've been moving houses and it's super busy. We are still on IFRS 16 or IND AS 116 on leases. I have covered most of the topics under this standard. The topics that I have remaining are one is lessor accounting and the other is sale and leaseback transactions. Now, this is the first video in a series of three videos where I will be taking up lessor accounting.
Hi, I'm Ranjini. Through my videos, I try to simplify complex accounting topics to help you understand them better.
This is the first video relating to the concept as well as the accounting treatment for finance leases. The second video, I will be solving examples of finance leases. And the third video will cover the comparatively less complicated topic of operating leases. Right, let's start then. Okay, in my first video, which is titled Why IFRS 16, I explained to you why a lessee does not have to classify the leases as finance lease and operating lease. Now, unfortunately, our lessor is not so lucky. A lessor needs to classify the leases, and it's important that he does this correctly because the accounting treatment is quite different for the two types of leases. Now, how do we classify leases into finance lease and operating lease? It is based on the risks and rewards of ownership of the underlying asset. This video, we will be dealing only with finance lease. Right. So what is a finance lease? A finance lease is a lease in which substantially all the risks and rewards of the ownership lies with the lessee. Put very simply, it is where the lessee can think of himself as the owner of the asset, although legally the ownership is not with him. When can you, as a lessee, think of yourself as the owner? Please keep this question in mind as we go through the examples of conditions that result in a finance lease. Now, these conditions could either exist individually or in combination. So, first of all, it is the price of the asset. Now, if the lessee ends up paying the entire price of the asset, maybe in installments, so when the present value of the lease payments more or less covers the fair value of the asset, it is a finance lease. The second one is the duration of the lease. Now, if the lease term covers substantially all of the economic life of the asset, then it could be considered a finance lease. The third one is the nature of the asset. If the asset itself is so specialized, only this particular lessee can use it and nobody else, in that case also we would consider it a finance lease. The next one is the ownership. When the lessor transfers the ownership of the underlying asset at the end of the lease term to the lessee, it would be considered a finance lease. The next one is the purchase of the asset. If the lessee is given an option to purchase the asset at the end of the lease term and the value at which he will purchase this asset, that is the exercise price, is much less than the market price of that asset. Only thing that we need to notice, at inception itself, it should be reasonably certain that the lessee would exercise this option to purchase. Now, these are the examples of conditions that are the favorites of examiners. Right? But our standard has given us some more examples. These examples, although they may not come very often in your exam questions, it helps us to understand the principle of a finance lease. If it is the lessee who bears any loss on cancellation of lease, provided the cancellation is initiated by the lessee, or gains or losses due to fluctuations in the fair value of the residual value of the asset. If the lease rentals are more based on the financing rate rather than the market rate of rent. And another one is that if the lessee has an option to extend the lease term, but the lease rentals in this extended period is much less than the market rate for rent of the underlying asset. Okay, so let's go into accounting for a finance lease. From a finance lease point of view, the lessors can be divided into two types. First are manufacturer or dealers, and all the other lessors comes under the others category. Why do we need to do this differentiation? Because the accounting treatment that a manufacturer, dealer, lessor does and other lessors do is slightly different. So let's start with recognition and measurement. Now, both the manufacturer, dealer as well as other lessors, they recognize the lease receivable from the lessee by debiting net investment in lease. I will go into this a little later. And because we consider the lessee as the owner, the asset is taken out of the books of accounts of the lessor. So they derecognize the assets that has been leased out by crediting the carrying value of the leased asset. Now, difference between this, the debit and credit, regular lessors would directly take that difference into the profit and loss account. But manufacturer and dealers, they need to recognize sale of this asset, and therefore they recognize the sales on the credit side, the cost of goods sold on the debit side, and indirectly the profit gets recognized in the P&L account, right? Okay, so now let's go into each of these components. The first new term that you are learning now is the net investment in lease, right? So net investment in lease is the present value of lease payments receivable plus the unguaranteed residual value. Now, what is included in lease payments receivable? It is, of course, the lease payments that he will receive from the lessee, as well as any residual value that is guaranteed either by the lessee or any party that is not related to the lessor. To this, we add the unguaranteed residual value. So, as the name suggests, if the residual value is not guaranteed by anybody, or it is guaranteed by a party that is related to the lessor, then it will also be added here. So this put together is known as the present value of the gross investment in lease. How do we calculate the present value? We discount the cash flows using the rate that is implicit in the lease. The next concept that we look at is the sales and cost of goods sold. So, what will a manufacturer dealer recognize as the sales? The sales revenue is the lower of the fair value of the underlying asset or the present value of the lease payments receivable. So, please do not confuse this with the net investment in lease. It does not include the unguaranteed residual value. Alright, so the next concept is the cost of goods sold. The cost of goods sold is calculated as the carrying amount of the asset less the present value of the unguaranteed residual value, right? Okay, so we go on to the next concept, and that is the initial direct cost. We already learned about this concept when we were talking about lessee accounting. Initial direct costs are expenses that are incurred to bring about the lease. Now, when these expenses are incurred by the lessee, if you remember, we used to add it to the ROU assets account. What does a lessor do? So, in case of a manufacturer or dealer, it's fairly simple. They just expense it out. But when it comes to other lessors, it gets slightly complicated. What needs to be done is the initial direct cost, or IDC, is included in the net investment in lease. Even in initial direct cost is included in the ROU asset, right? Yes, but the difference is their initial direct cost is separately added to the ROU assets account. But over here, the initial direct cost is supposed to get automatically included in the net investment in lease by an adjustment of the IRR, or the implicit rate of interest. When I read this, I was also slightly confused. So I went through all my sources to find an example of lessor accounting, including initial direct cost. Unfortunately, I could not find it. And therefore, I have solved the accounting example based on my own understanding of what this would mean. So, if we go into subsequent measurement, in case of a manufacturer dealer, it is fairly simple. It is similar to what a lessee does. That is, the receipt is split into interest as well as repayment of the principal. The repayment of principal gets credited to net investment in lease account. When it comes to the others, because of this addition of the initial direct cost, the lease payment received is split into three parts. First one is interest. The interest is actually reduced by the initial direct cost. And only the balance goes to the net investment in lease. In the example that I solve in my next video, I have included initial direct cost. But a disclaimer, it is entirely based on my understanding of the standard. So before you apply it, please consult a chartered accountant or your accounts teacher. If you have a different point of view on how the initial direct cost needs to be accounted for, please put it in the comment section. I am very curious about it and I am also open to learn. I will edit the video accordingly. Right? And now we come to the final topic, and that is remeasurement. What is remeasurement? Do you remember we had taken this up in the lessee accounting? Remeasurement is accounting for a change in the lease obligation arising on account of reassessment of assumptions that existed at the inception of the lease. So those kind of reassessments are not taken into consideration. We do not account for them. A lessor only accounts for a lease modification. What does that mean? If there is a change to the original scope, lease term or consideration, only then will a lessor account for it. And therefore, a lessor recognizes lease modification but does not recognize a lease remeasurement. Okay, so that brings us to the end of this video. Me listing the accounting entries would have left you quite confused. So please watch my next video where I actually solve examples. So the accounting entries will be very clear to you. Thank you very much for watching this video. Please send me your comments, your queries, suggestions for improvement. I really hope that you found this video helpful. Thank you. Bye.